Let us study the laser rate equations for 4 level laser. Let us consider the ideal 4 level laser as shown in figure, where E1, E2, E3 and E4 are the 4 energy levels and N1, N2, N3 and N4 are the populations of these 4 levels. Level E1 is the ground level, E4 is the pumping level, E2 and E3 are the lower level laser level and upper laser level respectively. Atoms are pumped from the ground level E1 to the pumping level E4. They make quick non-radiative transitions to level E3. We assume that this E2 is very greater than KT, and therefore at the normal temperature the level is not populated. So E2 level is not populated at ordinary temperatures by thermal process. It is further necessary that the level E2 has very small lifetime, such that atoms are not accumulated in E2 and spoil the population inversion condition between levels E3 and E2. Thus, the lifetime T2 of atoms in the level E2 is short compared to the lifetime T3 of atoms in the level E3. We are interested only in the rate of change of atomic density N3 in level E3 and N2 in level E2, right? So in this 4 level laser, let us consider that E1 is the ground state level, from where the atoms are pumped to the level E4. Since E4 has very short lifetime, the atoms they will remain there for very short time and they will fall back to the level E3. So E3 is a metastable state, so it has a lifetime of the order of 10 raised to minus 9 to 10 raised to minus 8 second, and therefore the atoms accumulate at level E3. And we are considering that E2 level is not populated due to thermal process. That means it is virtually empty as compared to the ground state level, and therefore there are no atoms in the level E2. So population inversion condition is created between level E3 and level E2, right? There will be transition from E3 to E2, so that will give us laser light output. Laser output will be in between, and again the atoms that are coming to level E2, they will fall back to level E1 very fast transitions. So this is fast decay to level E1, so fast decay. So these are non-radiative transition. And E3 is the upper laser level and E2 is the lower laser level. So now in this case, let R2 denote the rate at which atoms are pumped to level E4. So the rate at which the atoms are pumped to level E4, that is denoted by R2, and from there the atoms make a quick transitions, non-radiative transitions to level E3. So this transition is non-radiative. In effect, R2 represents the rate at which atoms are arriving in E3. So it represents the rate at which atoms are arriving at E3. Let R1 denote the rate at which atoms are pumped into level E2. So it denotes the rate at which atoms are pumped to level E2 from level E1, right? So the process R1 is detrimental to laser action, and it tends to reduce the population inversion condition between the level E3 and E2. So we know that population inversion is created between E3 and E2. Any rise in population in level E2, that will cause the reduction in the population inversion condition, right? But in the case of gas lasers, pumping into the lower laser level E2 is unavoidable, and consequently we take R2 into consideration. So in the case of gas lasers, we cannot avoid the pumping from level E1 to E2. So there may be pumping from E1 to E4, E1 to E3, and E1 to E2. But the pumping from E1 to E3, that will add up into our population inversion condition, so that will be useful. But the pumping from E1 to E2 cannot be avoided, right? The decrease in the number of atoms in level E3 has following components. So the decrease in the number of atoms, or the, let's say, the number of atoms, the rate of change of number of atoms in level E3 has following components. The first component is the stimulated transition to E2, which produces the lasing light, and which is given by W32 into N3 minus N2. Second component is the spontaneous emission to level E2, and which is given by N3 into A21. So if you see, there are transitions. So first transition is the stimulated transition to E2 from E3 to E2, and that transition we denote by W32 into N3 minus N2. Second component, which is the spontaneous transition from level 3 to 2, and that spontaneous transition again from 3 to 2, that we denote N3 into A32. So that will be the spontaneous transition. And third one is the process R2 that populates the level. That means the process R2 in which the atoms, they are coming to level E3, right? So in the process R2, we pump the atoms from E1 to E4, and these atoms, they will fall to the level E3, right? So all this process we denote in terms of E3, in terms of R2. Now, the rate of change of N3 with respect to T, that is the rate equation for N3, may be written as N3 dN3 by dt is equal to R2 minus W32 into N3 minus N2 minus N3 into A32. Let us call it equation number 1. Similarly, for level 2, the number of atoms is N2, right? So population is N2, and the rate of change of N2 with respect to 2, also we can write the rate equation, and which has following components. The first component is the stimulated emissions from level E3, and which is given by W32 into N3 minus N2. That is, we have already considered the stimulated transition from level 3 to 2, which is included into this component. Second component is the spontaneous emission from level E3 to E2, right? The spontaneous emission component is N3 into A32, where A32 is the Einstein's coefficients for spontaneous emission from 3 to 2. Again, the third component is the process R1, which pumps atom from level E1. So from level E1, some of the atoms that may be pumped directly to level E2, and that we include into process R1. And fourth one, the spontaneous emission to level E1 given by N2 into A21. So the atoms from E2, they will fall back to the level E1 or ground state by the process of spontaneous emission. So we say fast decay. So that spontaneous rate is N2, the number of atoms in the level N2, E2, into A21. So Einstein's coefficient for spontaneous emission from 2 to 1. Now, so we can write the rate equation for N2, dN2 by dt is equal to R1 plus W32 into N3 minus N2 plus N3 into A32 minus N2 into A21. Let us call it equation 1. So we have studied the steady state condition. So in the steady state, let us consider the number of atoms in the level 3 and 2, they remain constant, right? The number of atoms remain constant. That means the rate of change of atoms with respect to time is equal to 0, and therefore this dN3 by dt is equal to 0 and dN2 by dt is equal to 0. And therefore we can write this equation 1 and 2 as R2 minus W32 into N3 minus N2 minus N3 into A32, which is equal to 0, call it equation number 3, and R1 plus W32 into N3 minus N2 plus N3 into A32 minus N2 into A21 is equal to 0. Let us call it equation number 4. So, adding these two equations, so if you add equation 3 to equation 4, we can write R2 plus R1 is equal to N2 into A21, because this term will cancel out into the addition, and therefore we get R2 plus R1 is equal to N2 into A21. Since this R2 is very greater than R1, so R2 is the rate of pumping from level E1 to E3, and R1 is the rate of pumping from level E1 to E2, and we know that this rate R2 is much higher as compared to R1, and therefore we can write that R2 is equal to N2 into A21, right? But so we can write, therefore, for N2 is equal to R2 upon A21. So let us call it equation number 5. So by using equation number 5 into equation number 3, we can write. So if you use equation 5 into equation number 3, so equation number 3 is for R2. So if you use, so R2 is equal to W32 plus A32 into N3 minus W32 into R2 divided by A21, right? And N3 is equal to R2 into bracket 1 plus W32 upon A21 into another bracket 1 upon W32 plus A32. Let us call it equation number 6. And therefore we can write, if you subtract equation 6, equation 5 from equation 6, we can write N3 minus N2 is equal to R2 into A32 plus W32 upon A21 into W32 plus A32 minus 1 upon A32. So 1 upon A32 is the equation number 6, equation number 5. So that we are subtracting, and we are taking R2 common, right? So therefore we can write N3 minus N2 is equal to R2 into 1 minus A32 plus A32 upon A21 divided by W32 plus A32. And from the above equation, it is evident that this N3 minus N2 is greater than 0 if A21 is very greater than A32. That means the rate of stimulated emission from level 2 to 1, if it is very greater than 3 to 2, rate of stimulated emission from level 3 to 2, in that case we can achieve the population inversion in between level 3 and 2, right? If this rate is higher, that means the atoms that are coming at the level 2, they will fall back to level 1, and immediately they are available for again pumping, and in this case we can maintain the state of population inversion for longer time. So as A21 is equal to 1 upon tau 21 and A32 is equal to 1 upon tau 32, that are the lifetimes for level 2 and level 3. So therefore we can write the necessary condition for population inversion as tau 21 is less than tau 32. That means the condition is that the lower laser level, that is E2, must have lifetime lower than that of the level E3. That means the lifetime of level E3, right? So the lifetime for level E3 must be greater than that of the level E2. So this is the necessary condition for population inversion. So that means from the above condition, it is implies that atoms dropping to E2 level by spontaneous emission must be removed at a faster rate than the arrival rate. In this condition, if this condition is not satisfied, atoms accumulate at level E2, and however hard we pump, population inversion cannot be attained between level E3 and E2 levels. Hence, leaching action does not occur. So therefore, this is the necessary condition that we must have the lifetime of the lower laser level E2 less than that of the lifetime of the upper laser level E3. So this is the necessary condition for population inversion in four level laser level. Let us now study the threshold condition for laser. Below the threshold, the stimulated transition rate W32 is equal to 0. So we know that when the threshold condition is added, in that case only laser starts lasing, right? That means the stimulated emission starts at the threshold value, and below the threshold value there will be no stimulated emission. All the whatever the emission will be only due to the spontaneous, and therefore the stimulated emission rate will be equal to 0. That means W32 is equal to 0, and therefore we can write N3 minus N2 is equal to R2 into 1 minus A32 upon A21 upon A32. This condition continues up to the threshold level, right? Up to the threshold level, the number of atoms in the level E3, they are rising, and slightly the rate is increasing, and when the threshold condition is reached, that means the laser starts lasing, right? Therefore, the threshold value is given by N threshold is equal to N3 minus N2. We call it threshold is equal to R threshold into 1 minus A32 upon A21 upon A32. And since A32 is very, very less than A21, because the rate of stimulated emission, rate of spontaneous emission for level E3 to 2 is very, very less than that of this level 2 to 1, because the lifetime of this level 3 to level 3 is very high compared to the lifetime of level 2, and which gives the 1 minus 1 upon 32 upon A21 is nearly equal to 1, because the quantity is nearly equal to 0, and therefore which is equal to 1, and therefore we can write the R threshold is equal to N threshold into A32. So this A32 we take on this side, so we can write R threshold is equal to N threshold into A32, and therefore R threshold is equal to N threshold upon TO32, where TO32 is the lifetime of the upper laser level, that is E3 level, right? So this is the necessary condition for or threshold condition for the 4 level laser, right? Now let us compare the 3 level and 4 level lasers. In the case of 3 level laser, we can write N threshold is equal to N2 minus N1, and N0 is equal to the number of atoms, so that is N1 plus N2. For laser to begin lasing, we must have N2 greater than N0 by 2 plus N threshold by 2. That means the number of atoms in level 2, E2, in 3 level laser must be greater than the more than half of the atoms in the upper energy level, right? So N0 by 2 plus N threshold by 2. And as N0 is very, very greater than N threshold, so we know that this N0 is very, very greater than the N threshold, and therefore what we can write, the N2 is greater than N0 by 2. This is the necessary condition for population inversion to create in the 3 level system. So it is N2 must be greater than N0 by 2. Whereas in the case of 4 level laser, if we study, in the case of 4 level laser, what we have is N2 is equal to N1 into e raised to minus E2 minus E1 upon KT, right? So this N2 we can write in terms of Boltzmann's equation, रेस टू एच न्यू अपन के टू के टी, बट एच न्यू इज द डिफरेंस बिटवीन टू एनर्जी लेवल्स, सो इट इज ई टू माइनस ई वन. सो एन 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 टू इज इक्वल टू एन वन ई रेस टू माइनस ई टू माइनस ई वन अपॉन के टी, राइट. एंड अज्यूम लेट अस अज्यूम दैट ई टू माइनस ई वन अपॉन के टी इज वेरी वेरी ग्रेटर देन वन, एंड देयर फोर दिस एन टू इज इक्वल टू जीरो. दैट मीन्स द ई टू लेवल is in the four level laser is virtually empty. That means there are no atoms in the level E2, right? Since there are no atoms in the level E2, the whatever the atoms that they are coming in the level E3, they are readily available for the lasing action to start, because population inversion can be created with very few atoms, right? And they are readily available for lasers to start lasing, and we can say in the four level laser we can easily achieve the lasing action or laser oscillation because of this condition. So for laser to begin lasing, we can have n3 minus n2, that should be greater than n threshold. That means n3 greater than n threshold, or we can say the number of atoms in level 3 must be greater than the n threshold or threshold value of the number of atoms, right? So if we compare, or if we take the ratio of 3 level laser, threshold value for 3 level laser to the threshold value for 4 level laser, and then we can write it is equal to n0 by 2, it is for 2 level laser, 3 level laser into 1 upon n threshold, so it is dividing by n threshold, which is equal to, so this is a very large quantity, right? That means this ratio is very large quantity, and that means it is obvious that it is much easier to pump a 4 level laser than a 3 level laser. This is the reason why most of the lasers are of 4 level laser. It is because in the case of 3 laser level, what we have is the lower lasing level is the our ground state, right? And we know that the ground state population is, most of the atoms are in the ground state when the at the thermal equilibrium, right? And in the case of 3 level laser, we have to pump most of the atoms to the level E3. The atom, they will fall back to level E2, and when we create the state of population inversion, in that case only our laser can operate, right? So in order to create the population inversion in the 3 level laser, we have to pump at least more than half of the atoms to level E3. That means if you pump more than half of the atoms, that means if n0 is the total number of atoms, we have to pump more than half of the total atoms to level E3, the atom they will fall back to level E2, and then they are available for lasing, right? So this lasing or the population inversion condition between E2 and E1 cannot be maintained for longer time, because since the atom they fall back from E2 to E1 by stimulated or spontaneous processes, they again destroy the state of population level created between E2 and E1, right? And therefore, in the case of 3 level laser, we cannot maintain this state of population inversion for longer time, and therefore what we have is the 3 level laser is gives us a pulse output, right? So we cannot maintain this for longer time. That means laser will operate for shorter time or shorter duration, and again it will switch off. And again we need to pump the atoms and to the upper level, and again we need to create the state of population inversion, and again the laser will start lasing. So the output it will give us in the form of pulses, whereas in the case of 4 level laser, if we see the upper laser level is the level E3, that is the metastable state, and lower laser level is level E2, that is slightly higher than the ground state, and therefore the state of population inversion can be created between level E3 and E2, since the level E2 is virtually empty because it has energy slightly greater than the thermal energy due to the thermal agitation, and therefore whatever we have, we say that E2 level is virtually empty, right? And whatever the atom we pump to level E1, they will go to let's say from E1 to E4, this pumped atom they will fall back to level E3, and these atoms are readily available for lasing action because population inversion can be easily created in level E3 and E2, right? and since the atom they are readily available, they start stimulating emission to level E2, and our laser start operating, right? Since the lifetime of the level E2 is very short, and therefore due to the short lifetime, the atom they will fall back to the level E1, and they are readily available for again pumping to level E4, right? And in this process, process can be continued easily, and therefore we can maintain the state of population inversion for a longer time, and therefore we can get a continuous output from the 4-level laser. Similarly, the 3-level laser, if you see in the case of 3-level laser, we need large pumping power in order to maintain the state of population inversion. Here we can create the population inversion with very short power output, pumping power, and therefore we can say that most of the lasers are 4-level laser than the 3-level laser. Thank you very much.